Good morning. Welcome to worship this beautiful Lord's Day. It is good to have you here as we continue our journey with the parables and continue our journey with Jesus in the book of Matthew. A special welcome to those watching on Facebook Live. We pray that you will feel part of this community of faith as you hear the word spoken, as you hear the word of God's Son, and invite you to join in the liturgy with us as well. Just a couple of brief announcements to call your attention to. Vacation Bible School is coming up in August, and there is a sign-up sheet in the entryway just as you're leaving the sanctuary on the right. If you would like to help support our Vacation Bible School program by providing food or helping with an evening, helping with food and serving, or helping with crafts and being with the children, we could use your help. We are all children of God, and so all are welcome at Vacation Bible School. So I encourage you to stop and look at that list. For those watching on Facebook, we will give you tomorrow morning if you haven't registered your child yet. And so just take note of that for Vacation Bible School. Also, on Thursday, August 3rd at 6:30 in the evening, the Stephen ministers are hosting an evening event called Sharing Grief, Celebrating Life. It will be an opportunity for caregivers, as well as those who have lost loved ones, to come and gather together for an evening. There'll be food, of course, there'll be conversation. We'll have a place for prayer. We're going to just do a host of different activities that fall that evening in the church basement. A place to do some journaling, a place to pray, a place to light a candle in memory of your loved ones. So we'll have different tables set up where we'll have different activities. If you have questions, please see me after worship or give a call during the week as well. Good news, the quilt that the women made here that went up to Green Lake for their Green Lake quilt auction, the quilt sold for $550. So well done, good and faithful women. We are also looking for an adult who would be willing to serve as a volunteer coordinator for our National Youth Gathering, which will be next July, July of 2024. And it's for kids who have completed 8th grade through 12th grade. But Pastor Deborah and I just are looking for somebody to walk alongside of us to help with recruitment, to help with some of the registration, and to help with looking at chaperones and recruiting chaperones. And so if you have a passion for youth, or I know a number of you have gone to youth gatherings, see me, or I'll be seeking some of you out to see if you would be willing to help with that. We do have one other individual who's willing to serve, but he would like assistance in that position. Just a couple of people to keep in your prayer. Tim Imes is hospitalized in Sioux Falls and has asked for prayer, and just wanted to make this community of faith aware that Julianne Knudsen passed away yesterday at her home. Check the Wing Bank website for funeral details. It is tentatively being planned for Friday morning at 11 o'clock at Rock Valley Lutheran Church, and visitation is 1 hour prior to the service, but that's not in stone. Those are just some tentative dates and times that have been passed around. So we keep Denny and the rest of the family in our prayers today. Those are all of the announcements. I invite you to please stand for confession and forgiveness if you are able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who forgives our sins and whose mercy endures forever. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people. turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. May Almighty God strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. And we sing our opening hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
I am the last. Besides me, there is no God. Who is like me? Let them proclaim it. Let them declare and set it forth before me. Who has announced from of old the things to come? Let them tell us what is yet to be. Do not fear or be afraid. Have I not told you from of old and declared it? You are my witnesses. Is there any God besides me? There is no other rock. I know not one. Now we will read responsively from Psalm 86, verses 11 through 17. Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart to revere your name. Steadfast love toward me. You have delivered my soul from the depths of Sheol. But you, O Lord, are a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness.
Righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone with ears listen. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. May the words of our mouth and the meditations of our heart be acceptable to God, who is our rock, the sower, and our life. Amen. Here we are, another warm, sunny day with a haze kind of from forest fires. There are some things that are pretty predictable in our life, aren't there? Another Sunday in July in Series A, we hear from Matthew, the 13th chapter, for the second Sunday in a row. We hear more about seeds, more about planting, more about parable. Guess what? Come back next week, and we're going to pick right up where we're leaving off today. We will continue to hear about two more parables that Jesus is going to tell in Matthew 13. And guess what they're going to deal with? They're going to deal with seeds. So I do encourage you to look at chapter 13 in the Gospel of Matthew, because we are dwelling in this section for a while. The green season, with the green pyramids and all through summer, is called ordinary time. However, it's also called the season of growth. You think of green and plants as growing. And so our lessons in the summer deal with the growth of the church and the spreading of seeds and the spreading of the gospel. So that being said, let's look here. This parable is a little bit different than the sower that we had last week. Remember last week, the sower went out and just kind of scattered seeds all over. And I'm grateful that some of you have scattered seeds of faith and life this past week. And it was an optimistic, upbeat parable, that there is good soil, and that when we scatter seeds, we have this extravagant God who loves us and blesses us and watches over us, keeps nourishing, feeding us, gives us grace, hope, peace, and love to share. And so this week, this is a little bit more of a realistic or almost a pessimistic parable, you know, about weeds and wheat growing together. So we, I think, tend to want to make ourselves out to be the wheat, right? We're the good. The weeds are the bad. And the news I have for you today is Jesus says, guess what? You're at the same time wheat, good, the things growing and a harvest coming, but we also have some weeds in our life, weeds in our church, weeds in our community and our world. So let's kind of delve into this parable today. So perhaps one way to get at what is wheat in your life are these kinds of questions. The questions to ask ourselves is this: what brings you joy? Ponder that for a minute. What brings you joy in life? Or what brings a smile to your face? What relationships, values, and beliefs nurture your life? What are those things in your life that give your life purpose and hope and meaning? What relationships do you value? When you're having one of those no good, horrible, terrible, very bad days, who is it you turn to be built up? Who you know you can call when you're going through a rough spot? Those are the things that are wheat in your life. Those are the things that are the harvest of your life, that give your life purpose, meaning, and hope. Who are the people? What are the activities you do in the community with your family here at church that you just think, oh, I just so look forward to being part of that group or part of that activity? Those are the things that are wheat in the garden of your soul and in the garden of your life? And so I encourage you to ponder those during the week, and maybe it's just to sit with those questions and write down a few things. What brings you joy? What brings you hope? What are those things that you turn to, scripture passages or quotes that give you hope in the midst of uncertainty? And we are to plant those kinds of things in our life. They're already there, but we are also then to share with other people and bring joy and blessing into their lives. I love that image of the weeds, because you see, Jesus says in the parable, the weeds come at night. Isn't that interesting? I'll get to that in a minute. And the weeds had to be sown. Somebody planted the seeds of evil, the seeds of doubt, or the weeds of evil, the weeds of doubt. Someone planted them. Notice that it doesn't say the person who planted the weeds destroyed the weed. They could have burned the field. The evil one could have burned the weed field. The evil one could have caused the weed not to grow, or the evil one could have had the weeds choke out the weed. But no, the evil one just kind of planted the weeds, and they exist together. So what do we make of that? How do we make sense of those weeds in our life, in our community? And what are the weeds anyway in our life? And I don't think it's by chance that Jesus says the evil one planted the weeds at night. When is it you begin to doubt yourself? Isn't it at night? When you can't sleep, right? I'm such a failure. Oh, I forgot to do such and such today. Oh my goodness, what was I thinking when I said this to so-and-so? Or, man, I'm really worried about work tomorrow and the pressures at work. Or, my goodness, my family. I'm concerned for my grandchildren who are going through these such and such, right? Anybody have that happen where at night it's hard to shut the brain off and you just can't focus and go to sleep? Give me a call. I'm probably up to thinking of weeds. But those are the weeds that Satan plants to pull us away from being wheat. So perhaps some of the weeds that we have in our life, we all have them. I used to think that if I just did the right thing, if I worked hard enough, if I had good intentions, if I read Bible every day and said my prayers every day, that would lead to good seeds and wheat, and I would never have any weeds in my life. But I have weeds in my life. Weeds of feeling like I'm not enough. Weeds that I feel like I need to prove myself. What is choking off the good in your life? What is choking off the wheat of hope, joy, love, peace? Those are the weeds in your life that we need to get rid of. So I've been pondering and thinking of the church and our world. And we have all kinds of weeds. We have the weeds of discrimination. We have the weeds of being judgmental towards others. We have the weeds of sometimes looking at another person's life and say, well, you reap what you sow. So, and we make judgments about people and their beliefs. Have you ever felt better because someone else was struggling? Have you ever been unable to celebrate another's joy or success? Are you envious of another person? Those are weeds that we need to pull out. Are we holding grudges from the past that we need to let go of? Is there someone in your family or in the community that you've had a falling out with where you haven't been reconciled? Those are all weeds in our life. And do you ever replay old arguments in your head and wonder, why did I say that or what was I thinking? Those are weeds. And weeds are part of our life because it is called being human. However, the challenge for us is that we are called to deal with the weeds in our life. We get caught up sometimes in comparing ourselves to others and in competition with others. And so the last words of the parable are crucial. Let anyone with ears listen. How do we deal with the weeds in our life? We deal with the weeds in our life by listening to the word of Jesus. By listening that the wheat will grow, there will be a harvest, there is good, there is value. So what are the weeds in your life that you need to let go of? But don't just focus on weeds. Also remember to give thanks for those wheat that is growing in your life. Give thanks for the people who care about you. Give thanks for the joy you have. Give thanks for the blessing you have. That is being wheat. But let us also look at the weeds that are in our garden. And they're all over in our life and in our country right now with the attitude towards one another of trying to prove the other wrong instead of listening. That sense of blaming others instead of working together. And as a congregation, as we move forward into the call process, we are encouraged to be patient and wait. The wheat is growing. There will be a harvest. You will have a new pastor. I don't know when, but foundations are being laid. But we need to look at what is the wheat. What is the blessing of this congregation, and what are the weeds of the past that are holding us that we need to let go of so we can walk into the future? And so, what do we do? What are we called to do living with wheat and weeds in our life? We can't ignore the weeds, but how do we live with them? And I think the answer is something similar to the parable of last week. In the midst of our complicated world, we are still called to plant seeds. We are to spend more time planting seeds than pulling weeds. God will take care of the weeds. Satan has already been defeated. Jesus defeated Satan on the cross, and we are to let go of the past and to embrace a future that we do not know yet what that will look like. Our job, our calling, is simply to make sure that there is a harvest to gather as we scatter seeds. And so, I gave to you today in your bulletin an insert of our covenant that we agreed to at council. Many of you had input into this document, and I want us to just look at that for a minute, because you see, this is how we sow wheat. This is how we have a harvest of growth, of service, of mission, and ministry. How do we show respect to each other in this community of faith? It is to remind ourselves that each person is unique and deserves to be treated with respect. They may be different than you in their belief or how they live out their faith, but we are called to show that respect and to listen to their story as well. To sow weeds would be to disrespect somebody and ignore them, to say, they think differently than I do. Their view of the church is just wrong. It needs to be this way. That's not how we are to treat each other. This is how we have a harvest of the wheat. The golden rule, we believe that we reap what we sow, we pray. And this was written before you knew that we would have 3 weeks of the parable of the sower and seeds, for crying out loud. We reap what we sow, we practice love and compassion towards everyone, trusting that we will receive the same. Many of you grew up with that golden rule, right? Somebody was telling me every day when they went off to school, their mother would tell them, remember to play nice. Remember that everybody needs to be treated with respect and light, and it will come back to you, and people will do the same to you. Compassion, that is such a great word. It really comes from spleen, swapna, the spleen, the inner core of our being. Compassion is to feel something deeply. Compassion is to have concern for one another. Compassion is initiating with each other and finding out how they're doing and showing care. The opposite of compassion would be ignoring somebody going through a hard time. You ever get that where somebody puts a name in your brain and you think, gee, I maybe need to call that person, and you put it off and you put it off, and then when you do, they go, oh, I'm so glad you called, right? We are called to be people of compassion, people who care for each other. And honesty. Jesus was direct and honest with his people and the disciples, and so too we are to speak directly and honestly, expressing ourselves clearly. And listening. I think if there's something everybody wants, it is to be listened to. People want to be heard. People want their story told. People want to know that somebody will care for them. And finally, peace. Peace is not the absence of weeds. Peace is not the absence of struggle. But I love that quote that peace is like a duck or a loon skimming across the water. They look so peaceful and calm, and there's a little weight, but underneath their little feet are just a paddling and a moving. And that is peace, that in the midst of whatever we are going through, that we will promise that we will work together faithfully in building the church because it's God's church, not my church or your church. This is Christ's church. So how do we bring the peace of Christ to bear with one another? And so I encourage you to take that covenant with you. I don't want to see them in the trash in the entryway, but you agreed to this, so I want you to take it with you. Put it in your Bible, put it on your table, put it somewhere where you will see it and where you will pray for Granite Falls Lutheran Church. As we go into the future, Lord, let us be a place where patience is practiced, where we show compassion and kindness. The harvest will come. We can count on that, not because of who we are, but because of who God is. So let us go and sow more seeds in the week ahead. And let us also look at our life and rejoice in the wheat and the blessings we have. And let us be open to pulling and letting go a few of those things that choke us out. And at night when the enemy is seeking to put seeds of discouragement in you, may you also remember that Jesus, the light, is always with us. The light of the world is among us and in you as you share your wheat and as you share your blessings with one another. Amen. We sing our hymn of the day, and I am going to have Elaine play it through once, and Taylor, are you singing it once, or just Elaine playing it? Elaine will play it through once, and then we will sing The Reign of God is Like the Farmer's Field. Thank you. congregation to please stand, and together we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. Together with the whole church, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Confident that God receives our joys and concerns, let us offer our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of creation. God, guide your church as it seeks your wisdom, and as we share your wisdom, help us to trust your Spirit that is planting wheat in our lives. Lord, we pray for this congregation that you empower us to bring forth wheat and to sow seeds of love. Help us to live into the covenant of what we believe and how we treat each other. Cast out the weeds that choke out your love and your grace. Hear us, O God, your mercy is great. Creator God, you brought forth all creation and called it good. Direct policymakers to protect land and seeds. Bring rain to sun-parched fields. Protect the area from heat. Bring relief, Creator God, to your hurting earth. Come and help us to be co-creators with you as we care for your earth and what you have entrusted to us. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Your desire is peace among nations and peace among people. Guard and watch over police officers, firefighters, first responders, those serving in our military. Lord, we pray that you would bring peace to our homes, peace to our land. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. You are a gracious, merciful, comforting, and healing God. And so we pray for those who suffer body, mind, or spirit. We remember Steve, Tim, Mary, Imogene, Tim, and those we name in the silence of our hearts. In God of comfort, journey with Penny and the family of Julianne as they celebrate her life and mourn her death. Comfort them with your peace that passes all understanding. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Into your hands we commend all for whom we pray. In the name of the one who reconciled all creation to himself, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all. Let us share that greeting with each other. You may be seated and we will receive our morning offering. invite you to please stand. And together, let us pray. God of field and forest, sea and sky, you are the giver of all good things. Sustain us with these gifts of your creation, and multiply the graciousness in us, that the world may be fed with your love. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Lord.
Thanks be to God.